Well, thank you for joining with me in prayer. I'm not sure if Enoch announced it, but we will be canceling the evening service tonight for obvious reasons. I think it says it's going to be minus 45 with wind chill, so best just to stay home and enjoy a warm house with some hot chocolate. So, and then... And then we will resume. Well, actually, for the next two Sundays, it's going to be canceled because I'll be in Calgary next weekend. Fishers of Men, that is the theme or the title of this morning's message as we work our way through the Gospel of Mark. We're just beginning. And... looking at chapter 1, verses 14 to 28. In his in his book, None of These Diseases, S.I. McMillan tells the story of a young woman who wanted to go to college. And her heart sank when she read the question on the application form and asked, "Are you a leader?" Well, being honest, she wrote no and returned the application, expecting to get turned down. And to her surprise, she received this letter from the college. It said, "Dear applicant, a study of the application forms shows that this year, our college will have 1,452 new leaders. We are accepting you because we feel it is very important to have at least one follower." Well, today, we're looking at the Gospel of Mark and what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And as we saw last week, Mark's gospel describes Jesus on the move. Mark's gospel is a gospel of action, and he skips over a lot of biographical data on the Lord Jesus. For instance, he passes over the first year of his ministry. Jesus' first year of ministry is often called the year of obscurity. And if not for John chapter 1 to 4, we would not know about this aspect of his ministry. During his during his years of obscurity, Jesus was baptized. He was tempted by Satan. He gathered a few disciples, Philip, Andrew, Peter, James, John, Nathaniel. He went to Cana, turned water into wine. In Jerusalem, he had a heart-to-heart conversation with Nicodemus about the need to be born again. And then he left Judea and he went to Galilee. And on his way to Galilee, he met a Samaritan woman at a well. And as a result of this meeting, many believed in him. And then from there, Jesus went to Cana a second time and healed a boy close to death. And from there, he moved to Capernaum. And this brings us to the passage we're looking at this morning. And the takeaway statement or the thought that I want us to consider and unpack is that fishers of men accept the gospel of the Lord Jesus. Fishers of men respond to his call to follow him. Fishers of men serve him in the authority and power of the Spirit. Those are the three things that we will unpack as we work our way through this passage. And so let's look at the first one, that fishers of men accept the gospel of the Lord Jesus. We see this in verses 14 and 15, where it says, "Now after John had been taken into custody, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of God, and saying, 'The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.'" As we saw last week, gospel means good news. And for thousands of years, the world has looked for good news in various places, in religion, in knowledge, in the arts, in the science. It has looked for good news in many things. It has searched for a hope in relationships, in money, in fame. The world has run after charismatic leaders and counselors and teachers. It sought meaning in sex and drugs and alcohol. And every time and in every pursuit, the world comes up empty-handed. The world comes up disappointed and disillusioned because there is no good news in any of these things. No human pursuit can solve the problem of sin and death. No personal venture can give life beyond the grave. So then the question is, where do we find good news? Well, obviously we find it right here in the person of Christ Jesus and in the message he brings. Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God is near." And that is because the Son of God is near. And Jesus is the embodiment of the kingdom of God. If we want to find out what the kingdom of God looks like, we look to Jesus. But, and this may sound heretical, but please walk with me through this, the nearness of the Lord Jesus is not the good news. Jesus in our midst is not the gospel. The gospel is the reign of the Lord Jesus in our lives. You see, at that time, the Jewish people were looking for a political Messiah. They wanted a Jesus in their midst who would topple the harsh rule of the Roman regime. But Jesus must first be the king who reigns on the thrones of our hearts before he sits as king on a throne in Jerusalem. Jesus must move from the king in our midst to the king in our hearts. And as the Lord Jesus reigns in our hearts, we will know righteousness, peace, and joy. I want you to go with me to Romans chapter 14, verse 17, where Paul speaks of this. In verse 17 of Romans 14, he says, "The kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. It's not indulging in physical appetites. But the kingdom of God is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit." And so, the reign, the time for the reign of the Lord Jesus in your life is now. Today, you can become a subject of the king and know his righteousness, his peace, and his joy. But certain conditions must first be met, as Jesus tells us. And what are those conditions? Repent and believe. Last week, we talked a little bit about what repentance is and what it is not, and I want to unpack that a little bit more. Repentance describes what coming to God is like. For instance, if you live in Toronto and I invite you to come visit in Spruce Grove, I don't need to say leave Toronto and come to Spruce Grove, because coming to Spruce Grove is leaving Toronto. If you have not left Toronto, you will not arrive in Spruce Grove. In the same way, We cannot accept the gospel until we leave a life of sin. When I was 20, several decades ago, I finally said, I am done with my sinful lifestyle. And I moved from my sinful way of life to new life in Christ Jesus. And just like the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15, made up his mind to go back home. But in order to do that, he had to leave the pig barn. And so we must reject the idea of holding on to sin with one hand and taking hold of Jesus with the other. Most of us like to talk about Jesus loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life, but the beginning of the gospel is not, would you like to go to heaven? The beginning of the gospel is, we have sinned. And believe it or not, that is good news, because there is a solution to our sin problem. If I went to a doctor and he diagnosed me with a terminal illness, that would be horrible news. But if he also had a remedy that would deal with my terminal illness and allow me to live a long and healthy life, that would be good news. And so there is a solution to our sin problem. And that is repenting of our sin and believing in the Lord Jesus for salvation. And if you have not yet turned away from a lifestyle of sin, if you have not yet trusted in the Lord Jesus as your Savior, you are standing on shaky ground. Because you never know when the golden thread of life will break and you slip into eternity. We are one heartbeat, one breath away from either eternity in heaven or in hell. And at this time, I'd like to praise God that Jody had made that decision to turn from his sins and to trust in the Lord Jesus for salvation. And so now he spends eternity in heaven. And so if you're not right with the Lord, the time to get right is now. The door of opportunity is today. The Lord Jesus is in your midst. Invite him into your heart. As Jesus said, repent and believe in the gospel. Become a subject of the King and know his righteousness, his peace, and his joy. And so fishers of men accept the gospel. And then they respond to his call. Verses 16 to 20, it says, as he was going along by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net in the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were also in the boat mending the nets. And immediately he called them. And they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired hands or with the hired servants and went away to follow him. You see, the Lord first calls us to salvation and then he calls us to service. I'm reminded of the event that happened in the book of Exodus, where God told Moses to speak to Pharaoh. And so there's Moses standing before Pharaoh, and he says, on behalf of God, let my people go. Deliver them from their slavery. Set them free. Why? That they may serve me. The Lord calls us first to salvation, then he calls us to service. And Jesus does not recruit superstars, otherwise most of us would be left out. He recruits common people, like you, like me. Anyone who has accepted his message, anyone who has invited him into their heart can be included in his call. Lauren Cunningham, who is the founder of YWAM, Youth with a Mission, he once said, "The Lord does not call the qualified, he qualifies the called." And Jesus said, "I will make you become." The mission is his, not ours. The success of the mission depends on him, not us. He is the one who transforms. He is the one who says, "I will make you." He is the one who equips us for this great cause. And the phrase, "I will make you," suggests a process over time, a process that may involve leaving our safety net, leaving our comfort zone, as it says in verse 18, immediately they left their nets and followed him. They left their vocation, their source of living. And then in verse 20, immediately he called them and they left their father Zebedee. In this case, not only did they leave the business, but they left the family. "I will make you become" is a process that the Lord brings about in our lives that may involve leaving our comfort zones. We cannot follow the Lord Jesus until we are willing to forsake our plans and our pleasures. Peter and Andrew left their source of income. James and John left family and wealth. They were likely in line to inherit a gainful fishing business. And these men acted quickly. It says immediately. Because already the Lord had been working in their hearts. Remember, this is the second year of Jesus' ministry. So for the whole year prior, he had been working in their hearts. You know, when birds sense days getting shorter, it triggers in their instinctual system. They know it is time to begin their long migration. And in the same way, when Jesus commands us to follow him, it should elicit within us an immediate response. A response that may involve leaving our safety net. And notice, these disciples were working, hard-working men before they were called. And I think there's a principle for us here to consider. The principle is this: until you hear God's call, be faithful where you are. If you're a student, be the best student you can be. Be the best worker you can be. Be the best son or daughter you can be. Be the best husband or wife you can be. And also notice that James and John did not leave their father high and dry when they left the business to follow Jesus. It says here, they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants. The hired hands were able to pick up the excess labor that would be left behind because James and John left. They were able to pick up the excess labor so that Zebedee would not suffer a setback in his business. And so the principle here is that we are to set our affairs in order before we follow the Lord. In fact, we see this principle being carried out as well. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, this is when David was commanded to go and deal with Goliath. And notice in verse 20, it says, David arose early in the morning and left the flock. Well, not quite. He left the flock with a keeper, someone to look after the affairs while David was gone. And took the supplies and went as Jesse had commanded him. And so we are to set our affairs in order before we follow the Lord. Now you may be asking, okay, this sounds interesting, but how is this practical? How is it practical to leave my source of income, my job, or whatever? How will I provide for my family? Well, I want us to go to Luke chapter 4. Sorry, Luke chapter 5, verses 4 to 11. So here Jesus has finished speaking. He said to Simon, Simon being Peter, put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch. And Simon answered and said, Master, we worked hard all night and caught nothing. You see, the time for fishing is at night because the fish come to the surface and it's easier to catch them. And it was all futile. But I will do as you say and let down the nets. And when they had done this, they enclosed a great quantity of fish and their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat for them to come and help them. And they came and filled both of the boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw that he fell down at Jesus' feet saying, Go away from me, Lord. It's interesting. In verse 5, he called Jesus Master. Here he calls him Lord. Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. For amazement had seized him and all his companions because of the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, Do not fear. From now on you will be catching men. And when they had brought their boats to the land, they left everything and followed him. And that's because they came to understand that the Lord is able to supply beyond measure. And so, in following the Lord, we may have to say no to some of our plans, to some of our family's wishes. We see this even in the life of Abraham. Back in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1, let's go there. It says, Now the Lord said to Abraham, Go forth from your country. A country that he was familiar with. He was familiar with the culture, familiar with the way of life. And go from your relatives, from your father's house, all that was familiar and comfortable to him. And go to a land which I will show you. A land he is not familiar with, a culture he's not familiar with, a people he's not familiar with. But that's how it is with the Lord. Is that when he calls us, we often have to say no to our own plans and our own desires and even our family wishes. So God's call may involve leaving your safety net. And the question then is, what are we called to? Well, notice what these disciples were doing when Jesus issued the call. Andrew and Peter were casting their nets into the sea, into the water, and casting nets is a symbol of evangelistic ministry. You throw your net and you have a harvest of fish or catch a fish. And the sea in Scripture is often a symbol of a mass of people. And James and John, what were they doing when Jesus called them? They were mending their nets. And the word mend is an interesting word. It means to fix what is broken, to prepare something for future use. That's what they were doing with the nets. They had broken and they needed some mending. They needed some fixing to make them ready for the next fishing excursion. The word is sometimes used to fix a broken bone. And other times in Scripture, the same word is used for equipping. Equipping, mending. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 to 13. Here Paul says that the Lord gives to the church some as apostles, some as prophets, some as evangelists, some as pastors and teachers. Why? For the equipping of the saints, for the mending of the saints, because we're broken. Sin has broken our lives. We're not fit for service. And so we need to be mended. We need to be equipped. And God uses the leaders to help equip the saints, to help mend them, to make them fit for service. You see, to be fishers of men is a global mission. It begins here locally, but it also has global implications. We are fishing for men and women from every ethnic group, from every social class, from the rich and the poor, across the four corners of the earth. To be called fishers of men means some may be evangelists, leading men and women to faith in the Lord Jesus. Others may be called to leadership to help equip building up the believers. But here's the thing, when Jesus calls, it will resonate with your history. It will resonate even with your talents and abilities. It will resonate with your desires. But even if you don't desire the mission that the Lord calls you to, admit it before the Lord. It is not our job to desire the mission, it is His. I remember when I was in fourth year university, the University of Guelph, and I remember having a conversation with a friend of mine who was also in fourth year in the university, and we were trying to figure out, well, what's the next step once we graduate? And I was a student in biomedical sciences, and I was thinking at that time, well, maybe I'll apply to University of Western Ontario and some department of physiology and do a master's degree, a PhD, become a professor. That's kind of what I was thinking. That's where I was kind of aligning myself. And then my friend shared what he was thinking. And then he looked at me and he said to me, he said, Josh, I think you should be a pastor. And I looked at him stunned, like, you got to be kidding me. That was the last thing on my radar. The desire at that time was not there. But then fast forward 5 years later, and I'm a student in seminary. And so it is not our job to desire the mission. It is His job. He will give us the desires to serve Him. And I'm so happy that the Lord led me in this direction. He will prepare us for what He's called us to. He will give us the desire to carry it out. And so what we're seeing here from this passage is that fishers of men accept the gospel of the Lord Jesus. They respond to His call to follow Him. And the third thing is they serve Him in the power of His Spirit. I'm going to read verses 21 to 28 and comment on it a little bit and then make some applications. Verse 21, it says, they went to Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath He entered the synagogue and began to teach. And they were amazed at His teaching, for He was teaching them as one having authority and not as the scribes. And just then there was a man in their synagogue with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, saying, what business do we have with each other, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. And Jesus rebuked him, saying, be quiet and come out of him. And throwing him into convulsions, the unclean spirit cried out with a loud voice and came out of him. And they were all amazed, so that they debated among themselves, saying, what is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even unclean spirits, and they obey him. And immediately the news about him spread everywhere and to all the surrounding district of Galilee. You see, Jesus here served with authority. But He also served from a posture of humility. Authority flows from humility. As James said, God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. And once we have learned to submit to the Lord, He entrusts His authority to us. For example, let's go to that famous passage we all know in the Great Commission, Matthew 28, verse 18. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. And the implication here is that the authority given to me, Jesus gives to us. Why? So that we can go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I command you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. And so the Lord entrusts his authority to us so that we might serve him. And then if we go to 2 Corinthians, a similar statement here made by Paul, chapter 10, verse 8 in 2 Corinthians. For even if I boast somewhat further about our authority, which the Lord gave. The Lord gave Paul authority. Why? For building you up, not destroying you. We are not to use our authority to oppress people, to tear them down. God gives us authority to build up, to equip. And then in chapter 13 of 2 Corinthians, a similar statement made by Paul, verse 10, for this reason I am writing these things while absent, so that when present I need not use severity, in accordance with the authority which the Lord gave me. Again, the Lord delegates his authority to his servants. For what purpose? For building you up and not tearing you down. And so we should never use our authority to oppress people, to tear them down, to enslave them. We use his authority to build people up. And he has given us his authority to proclaim his word. The scribes at the time of Jesus, they were the interpreters of scripture. They taught by quoting the rabbis that came before them. We have scribes today. They are experts in this topic or that topic. We find our scribes on TV talk shows, and we read their blogs, we listen to their podcasts, we buy their books. They have a lot of good things to say, but the wisdom of these experts is from the world. And what we need is not a word from experts, we need a word from God. And Jesus did not teach from the textbooks of the rabbis. Okay, well, the Talmud wasn't written at this point, but there was an oral tradition that the rabbis taught from. And Jesus did not teach from that oral tradition. Instead, he taught the word of God. And he taught it with the authority of God. And so the Lord equips us to proclaim the word. And he gives us his authority to carry out his mission. And not only do we have the privilege of proclaiming the word of God in the power of the Spirit, we will also be given power to do the works of God. As we proclaim the word of God with power and authority that the Lord gives us, as we serve him according to his will, we will encounter demonic activity seeking to hinder our labors. It's a given. Just as Jesus encountered every place he went, opposition. You see, in our service for the Lord, we will be interacting both with clean and unclean fish. And the word of God serves to expose what is in a person's heart. And then gives us the authority and the power to perform good works that bring about healing and restoration, just as Jesus brought about in this man. His ministry elicited a demonic manifestation, and by the power of the Spirit, he was able to heal this man and restore him. And so in conclusion, what we are seeing is that the message and the miracles of Jesus had an impact on people. It brought forth a response of awe and wonder. Right? As it says in verse 27, they're all amazed. What is this teaching? You see, the church doesn't need slick programs. The church doesn't need high-tech gadgets. Doesn't need fancy buildings. I mean, these are not bad things in and of themselves, but we don't need these things to attract people. The best advertisement for the church in our community is to proclaim the word of God and to do the works of God in the power and authority of the Spirit of God. And so will you be a fisher of men? Will you follow the Lord Jesus in this great mission? Well, it begins by accepting the gospel. It begins by admitting our sin, by admitting our need for a Savior, by believing that Jesus died for our sin and rose from the dead, and by calling on His name. Being a fisher of men begins by accepting the gospel, by leaving our lifestyle of sin and clinging to the Lord. And then it involves responding to His call. He will equip you to serve Him in His great mission. And as you learn to submit to the Lord Jesus, He will give you His power and His authority to proclaim His word and to perform His works. And so those are the three takeaways that I want us to consider as we leave today. Accept the gospel, follow Him, accept His call, and serve in the power and authority that He gives you. Why don't we pray? Lord, we thank You so much for this great salvation that You've called us to. Thank You for this service that You've entrusted to us. Thank You for the resources that You've supplied, especially Your Holy Spirit. And Lord, we have everything that is needful for us to serve You in a way that honors You, in a way that bears fruit. And so, Father, I just pray that we would learn to submit to Your Lordship, that we would walk in step with Your Holy Spirit, that we would perform the works You've called us to, and that we would bear much fruit for You. And if there's people in the sanctuary listening online who don't know You in personal relationship, Lord, may the first step is for us to come to know You, to repent of our sin, and to believe in You for salvation. And so I pray that if there is anyone here or listening online that has not come to that place of accepting You into their lives, Lord, may Your Holy Spirit convict them of their sin, convince them of the need for You, and that they would call on You for salvation. Thank You, Father, for this wonderful privilege of knowing You in personal relationship and of serving You. And again, thank You for the testimony that Jody left behind, testimony of a man who trusted You even in his weakness, who knew that there was a resurrection, that there is a resurrection. And thank You, Father, that all of us have that hope of eternal life in You. We just commit the remainder of our day to You in Jesus' name. Amen.